This is a simple account of a year in 4-5 Commando. It was a year that it was times hard, tough and violent, but never boring. The film sequences were made on a cheap little camera and about 40 years later rescued, much scratched. This account is also a narrow view. It has to be narrow because on operations, which we were on for most of the year, one lived in a small, tight community. My compliments to the Yankees, the Zulus, support company, headquarters, and of course the TAC HQ. This is very much their story as well. Towards the end of January, 4-5 were embarked on HMS Centaur, a strike carrier, not one for carrying troops, and sailed down to Dar es Salaam in Tanganyika, where they assaulted the Kalito barracks and disarmed the mutinous 1st Battalion of the Tanganyika Rifles. That same day, X and Y companies flew up to Tabora, about 400 miles inland, where they disarmed the 2nd Battalion. So within 24 hours, 4-5 had taken over Tanganyika. A few days later, ship hopping via HMS Victorious, another strike carrier, and HMS Albion, a commando carrier, 4-5 went back to Aden, having put Robert Nyerere back into power, and Tanganyika shortly afterwards became Tanzania. Our home was in a shabby camp in Little Aden, across the bay from the main peninsula of Aden itself. No sooner had we got back than one troop was on the move again, this time by itself. I was briefed to take one troop to a place called Fort Thamir. This was 50 miles north of Aden, accessed through some pretty wild roads. Fort Thamir, later known as Habalane, was the operations base for the Federal Republican Army to whom we were attached, who were then conducting a small war called Operation Nutcracker in the Radfan Mountains. The troop were tasked to do the night work for the FRA. This meant going out on patrol into areas like the Danube Basin, but most often being assigned to patrol and lay ambushes around an area of the village called Shab Tem. We had no contacts in that period, and our last job was to act as the rear guard for the FRA when they withdrew from the mountains. These weeks have been a great experience, but what we didn't know was that there had also been superb training for what was to come. I was then able to take a look at Aden, and I discovered that if you want to buy a complicated thing like a little cine camera, having oppos with you is a pain. Their ideas never correspond to the width of your wallet. We didn't realize it at the time, but we were about to say goodbye to the days where we could walk around unescorted. The harbour area then was a mecca of tourists and locals looking for the cheap, duty-free bargain. Above us towered Shamsan. Shamsan was an extinct volcano that dominated the Aden Peninsula. And below, in it, in the crater of the extinct volcano, was the town, aptly named of Crater, which nestled or festered there. They said that if you climb Shamsan, you would never return to Aden. So I took my little cine camera and I climbed it. And I didn't return to Aden. Well, the nearest I got was a few miles offshore some years later in the frigate HMS Tartar, covering the withdrawal of British forces. Soon, X Company were on the go again, but this time in a different role. Thank you. At the end of April, the unit was on the move. The whole unit moved up to Fort Tamir to start operations against the dissident tribesmen in the Radfan. I think that the higher authorities call this period the break-in. Well, 4-5 broke in. They kicked the door in and broke in. Led by our Colonel Paddy Stevens, 4-5 embarked on a very difficult night march. This involved about 400 very heavily laden men snaking through some narrow passes, a lot of falling, a lot of tripping, a lot of whispered swearing, a lot of bad language, heading for our objective, a dominating peak codenamed Cap Badge. We didn't get to Cap Badge. Colonel Stevens had orders to change his plan. A supporting para drop of a company of 3 para was aborted because the Pathfinders, an SAS patrol, were caught and mauled at a place called Shabtem. This is where one troop had been patrolling just a few weeks earlier. So Colonel Stevens, with no maps and just some hazy air photographs, in the middle of the night revamped his plan and halfway took 2 ridges, codenamed Coca-Cola and Sandfly, and there we sat for 3 days. 3 days later we went on and took Cap Badge, with B Company of 3 para having a hard fight below us. They did well. I'm afraid the mountains of the Radfan were no place for a cine camera. We had enough trouble carrying ourselves, our water, our ammunition and all the other spares. This means the pictures you see are those of 4-5 going up in convoy and 4-5 after the first week in the Radfan. I think this music is more suitable. This was Top of the Pops at the time, and coincidentally it was also the troop password. So we surprised the rebels, and many others, with the ability to operate in the mountains in the hottest months of the year. Most of our movement was done at night, but after a few days we had become more or less accustomed to the heat and we learnt to live with it. We moved off as lightly equipped as we could be at the end of April, and 9 days later we came out tattered, dirty and torn, and quite tired, but able to do it again. So after that first stint, we went back to Little Aden. Here for 9 days, we relaxed, reorganised, got sorted out, and got ourselves ready to go back. The next stint in the hills went without incident until the end, when the unit went back, but X Company was detached and put under the command of 3 Para for a special operation. This was to be a raid into the Wadi Dipsan in the heart of the Radfan Mountains. A lot has already been written about this operation. So briefly, at dawn, X Company found themselves at the foot of the Wadi Dipsan, having scrambled down 2,000 feet of nightmarish rock and shale. X Company had been tasked to clear the Wadi bottom. Major Mike Banks, our company commander, had concerns, one of which was as to whether the pickets would be in position before we started to advance. They weren't. And as we moved further down the Wadi, he decided to put his own pickets up. The first one was a section from one troop under Willie Patterson. They saw tribesmen above them where the pickets should have been, and they opened fire. And that's when it all started. The company came under ever-increasing fire from the hills above, from tribesmen or dissidents, well concealed in heavily fortified rock sangars. At this stage, there were further complications because a helicopter which had been floating around in front of the company was shot down, well in front of the company. The passengers were rescued and put under cover. Still without our covering pickets, this had dangerously extended X Company. 2 troops started to move up on the left-hand ridges. Elements of 3 troop got into the 2 stone forts on the right of the Wadi, and the 2 sections of 1 troop clambered up onto the ridge above the forts. The firefight continued for some time, and then the para pickets got into position. The RAF hunters, which had flown superbly all day, had obviously been a great effect. Also Eric Bly's and his Vickers MMGs. The fire stopped late in the afternoon. X Company lost 4 good men that morning, and after an uneasy night, the next morning climbed the 2,000 feet back up out of the Wadi. When we got to the top, we found that 3 Para had gone, but we were met by Sergeant Eric Blythe and his Vickers machine gunners, who gave us a cup of tea. That cup of tea, I think, was the best cup of tea I have ever had in my life. After a rough night, the company was flown down to Habberlane by choppers the next morning. Mind you, 1 troop were the last out because they'd had to walk halfway down the ridge to provide an intermediate picket to cover the helicopters. 'Twas ever thus, so let's take a closer look at some of 1 troop.
They really back it in.
After the Duksan raid, X Company turned its face north and went back up to Dala on the Yemen border. Here, a day later, our company commander, Major Mike Banks, assembled the entire company and held a detailed debrief, taking input from all ranks. The X Company experience turned out to be a bit different from the official report, which came out a bit later. Up at Dala, we were at 4-5 Second Home. Dala was always a popular place. It's 80 miles north of Aden and quite close to the Yemen border, situated at 5,000 feet. This gives it a super climate, hot but not humid during the day, and at night it's blankets and woolly pullies. In June of 1964, things were still relatively quiet at Dala. This enabled the company to play football against the locals. We took care, of course. It was also very feasible to go out on longer ranging patrols, usually at about troop strength. We were certainly made welcome by the local villagers. The trick, of course, was to keep all four wheels on the road at the same time, otherwise you had problems. The commando camp was situated on a long, narrow ridge. The 4-5 had been occupying this camp for about 6 or 7 years now. All in all, it was a good place to be. Away from the unit, great climate, a place to get fit. X Company, in June of 64, relaxed here. Things were to change, however, in the next few weeks. For a start, as one can see from these films, the defences needed shoring up. But here in June, the company relaxed, played volleyball, kept fit, and smartened itself up after the two Radfan tours. Well, if you feel it and like it, go get your lover, then reel and rock it. Roll it over, then move on up. Just a trifle further, then reel and rock with one another. Roll over Beethoven, dig these rhythm and blues. However, in July things were to change because 4-5 went back into the Radfan for its third tour, leaving X Company up at Dala. The unit was stretched, and so support company was converted into a rifle company but needed boosting with the addition of an extra troop. One troop went back on the job and they found themselves on the high Jebel Wadena doing the patrol work for S Company. One particular patrol stands out. Early in the morning of the 24th of July, a long way out, about a mile and a half out in the Wadi Ayman, we were able to even the score with interest. For the rest of that day, things got a bit iffy, but 36 hours later, the patrol got back onto the Wadena, very tired, very thirsty, but in one piece. Then it was back to Dala, where things had begun to change. The camp had started coming under attack. The long-range jaunts in the countryside had gone, and we settled into a different routine. As a matter of priority, the defences were tidied up and sandbags were filled and barbed wire restrung. Every night, one of the three troops would be out on patrol. One of the three troops would be on guard duty, and one of the troops would have the night off. We still played volleyball though. Then in August, it all changed again. The Foreign Office had decided to build a radio station and pump propaganda into the Yemen. The only trouble was they needed somebody special to guard it. One troop get fell in. So one troop departed Dala and went to Perim Island. Perim Island's a small island about 2 miles long at the foot of the Red Sea, about 2 miles off the coast of the Yemen. For over 100 years, it had been a key coaling station for ships travelling between the Red Sea and India. Now, for the last 40 years, it had been lying abandoned and in ruins. Perim, however, did have a distillation plant, an old distillation plant, but it worked, and people would come for fresh water for miles up and down the coast. I thought that this music, which was top of the pops at the time, would be suitable, but actually the music flatters Perim. There is no doubt that this deserted island was the hottest, the most humid and about the most uncomfortable place I've ever had the privilege of serving. And also, after the excitement of the previous 6 months, Perim was starting to be boring. I know that one troop were glad to say goodbye to Perim, but I said goodbye to one troop before that. I flew out of Perim and found myself back in the Radfan, this time as intelligence officer to Paddy Stevens. I know that for Zulu, Yankee and support company, this was an eventful tour. For me, it was a bit different operating out of the TAC HQ tent. At the end of this tour, it was back to Little Aden. It was goodbye to Paddy Stevens, hello to Robin McGarrell Groves, training in Silent Valley and preparing for the internal security duties that the commando was to get involved in. These last few shots are of recce troop training in Silent Valley. I'd like to finish where we began, with the barren rocks of Aden. But before we do that, let's remember those that we left behind us.